Now regarding medical issue, then we have to do the repeatedly just to prove that as per cultural sensitivity, we have given the antibiotic to the patient.
Exactly. So there are certain cases which are gone against the orthopedic surgeon because they have not sent only cultural sensitivity. Whether the surgeon was for an arthroplasty infected case, he was penalized for 16 lakhs plus 20 years of the interest on that. Just because they have not sent the cultural sensitivity on the day one, he sent it later on. But if he sent on day one, that was one point which was taken by judiciary who penalized the doctor.
Whether you do or not, paperwork should be perfect. You should have the cultural sensitivity reports and as per that report we are given everything.
In the current scenario, we have to discuss along with the academics what are the medical implications in the given case. And we brought in India at least. Anybody wants to ask anything?
Yeah, we can go ahead with that.
Thank you, Professor Vipin Sharma. For our wonderful case in two minutes. I invite Professor Sandeep Kalia from Mandi to present his case. Dr. Kalia, sir.
Good learning points from this case, Dr. Sharma.
Thank you, sir. Okay, am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll be presenting the case of infected non-union of femur. That's a complex non-union, but it's a common scenario we see in our day-to-day practice. A 25 years old male, a young patient, he presented to us after 4 months of his index operation, index operative surgery, and he presented with this x-ray with the plate in situ, and there was an active draining sinus, and sinus was somewhere from this place. So when we reviewed the record of the patient, he had a fall 4 months back. He was a laborer, he had a fall, and he sustained a closed fracture of distal femur. He was operated at a peripheral level with a 9-hole LCP. Looks fine. But 1 week post-operative, he started having fever and discharge from the wound. And for this, the patient underwent debridements 3 times. And as per his history, there was a big amount of pus, or what we call the pouring pus. The wound was left open with the plate covered with the muscle tissue. And he told that SLG was done after the 3rd debridement. But infection was still persisting. So there were now the draining sinus. So, we thought, let us do another debridement, and we did another debridement with a sinus tract excision, and we put antibiotic bead cement, and we hope that we will clear the infection and we will take out the non-union later on. But 4 weeks later, patient came back, infection was still persistent. At this point, we assessed the patient thoroughly and we tried to evaluate all the problems the patient was having. Now looking back the previous x-ray, we saw active sinus, there is a osteomyelitis involving almost half of the femur. There was a soft tissue scarring. He had already undergone 3 or 4 surgeries. There was a disused atrophy. His knee was stiff. The organisms, we were reviewing the reports, there were multi-drug resistant organisms. And we expected after the bone debridement, there will be a gap and there will be a limb-length discrepancy. So all these are the problem numerated. So how to tackle all this? Radical debridement of the scar tissue and the sequestrated bone, but up to what extent of the bone debridement? To tackle the infection, we ought to give the antibiotics to the patient. Now how to, what should be the delivery of the antibiotic? Should it be local? Should it be systemic or should it be both? And how to stabilize the patient after that radical debridement? Should it be internal, external, should it be temporary? And how will it fill the bone loss? With the grafting, the transport, or at our scenario, we will say a highly technical surgery, vascular bone fibrograph, or we will accept the shortening. Should it be a single stage surgery or should it be a stage surgical procedure? all these were the two animal mice. So the review of the literature suggests that the treatment must be tailored to the individual patient, addressing the components of the problem, all the components of the problem. The technique of distraction osteogenesis with the ring external fixator or the modulator railroad fixator, in literature they are reported to achieve excellent or good result in up to 60 to 70% of the cases, but just 30% of cases the results are fair. 50% is the poor also. Both these techniques, but they are having a predictable complications, the pain gets loosened, the stiffness is there, neurological complications are reported, and refracture is a common complication with this. The local antibiotic delivery attains high concentration locally and it avoids a systemic toxicity. So now routine we use it for all these things. Literature approves this also. Early referral to the tertiary center would reduce the morbidity and the cost in these complex non-units. And with due respect to all, I would like to add not only the referral to the early tertiary centers, but the acceptance of the patient also at the tertiary care centers. The cyclic compression distraction stimulates healing and may obviate the need for the bone grafting. So we discuss everything with the patient. I had a plan to, rather temptation to debride the bone up to this year. But and doing the corticotomy and then doing the bone transport. But all the pros and cons were explained to the patient. The patient was retained and I must bleed here. Somehow even the surgeon was also retained. So, because if this surgery goes to the failure, the amputation is inevitable. So what was done? We removed the plate, there was a butterfly fragment, frustrated, which was taken out, and patient was temporarily stabilized with the antibiotic nail. I tell you the background of the patient, he was a laborer, had already undergone multiple surgeries, and a poor patient, we will say. And we took a K-nail, mixed the antibiotic in the cement. We chose the canine because one side is open, so that you had a mind, what we call is peace of mind, that antibiotic delivery will be good, and it's a cheaper option. So we fixed it temporarily with the antibiotic nail for the infection. And 6 weeks later, everything was looking good, but at this point, in the mid shaft, a little bit posterior on the later side, he was having a fluctuating collection. We opened it, it was sort of a dead space, there was a collection, we divided it again, and we put a block of antibiotic to obliterate the dead space and give the antibiotic delivery also. We applied the reserve ring, we did not do the debridement up to this level. We just took the restricted fragment out, and this was a, I must say, bone was not, it was a restricted bone. And this reserve was applied, and we did give two cycles of compression distraction and before finally compressing the fracture. The fixator was kept, I think it was for 4 to 5 months. There was one pin region which was changed. Now, this is actually after 2 years. The fracture has united. It has united with a shortening. Shortening is approximately 6 to 7 cm. And the knee is stiff. This is a gate video. Recently, we requested the patient to send his gate video. It's almost now 3 years now, 3 years follow. This young boy is now employed with the electricity department. He is in his livelihood, but retrospectively, I think a young patient, young person, who sustained a simple standard fracture of a distal femur, he had to undergo 8 surgical interventions. And it took almost 14 months for the bone to unite. And when the bone united also, it united with a shortening, significant shortening, and a stiffening. So I was thinking what went wrong and what went wrong. What could have been the options also, other options. So we checked it. Take home message, I have left it open, blank, just to learn from the learned faculty, all the members. And it will be, that will be the discussion, that will be a take home message for me also. References are from the this literature regarding the non-union, infected non-union, application of the ring fixators, railroad fixators, antibiotic delivery systems. Thank you, but I would like to have a discussion for those questions. So the answer to those questions will be the take-home message for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Karya, for the wonderful presentation and the great case. Well, we will go step by step, one by one. How many days later you remove the plate after that you find the infection?
Sir, the hospital already 4 months. So what we did, we retained the plate, we put antibiotics in. Then we call the patient after 4 weeks. We assess if any problem is there. And the patient, patient came after 4 weeks. After 4 weeks, we removed the plate. So it, from the index surgery, it becomes a 5 months.
In the days before he came to you, since when he had infection?
His infection
came to you before that, say 3 months to 2 months, 1 month. When he found the infection? Infection was there for how much time? Because what is important, I am saying.
From the index surgery, 1 week post-operative from the index surgery, he started having infection.
So it was immediate post-op infection, which lingered there for 4 weeks. In such a situation, when there is surface implant, generally surface implant, they tolerate the infection poorly as compared to the intramedullary implant, that's one thing. Of course, the metal which is there, the titanium is there, it can tolerate it better than the infection. So, where do you find? We will take a message one by one. So, yes. First thing is, whenever the patient, in our scenario, generally we wait for maximum 1 month for the surface implant if you find the infection. The infection doesn't come down, infection will never come down unless you remove the surface implant. So surface, to reduce the time, we have to remove the surface implant at the earliest. The second part was after the removal of the surface.
Infection was evident immediately postoperatively, the implant had to go out. So that is the one message. So that the time was lost in the repeated debridements, wherever they were done.
Second thing is, whenever rather you should avoid multiple surgeries, because whenever you are operating patient, then there is more scar formation and the more fibrosis and the more stiffness occurs. So we have to see that we reduce the number of the interventions in chronic cases. Now, second, we go for the after removal of the implant, you put the antibiotic nail. Antibiotic nail acts, we think it has got two purposes. One is the stability and second is providing the antibiotic at the local site. So here the diameter, the canal is used mainly for the antibiotic delivery rather than the stability. So for the antibiotic delivery, you should have more number of the amount of the antibiotic. So we should use the smaller canal with a more cement around that, so that it helps us to deliver more antibiotic at the local site. But then when you use a smaller canal, it doesn't give the stability. So for that, you have to put additional, because it is in the distal third. There is an issue of the stability. So it is better that we should use a smaller nail with antibiotic and give additional stability, either as Professor Vipin Sharma has done as eczema fixator, or Dr. Chandak has suggested for the outside the eczema immobilization like a splint or brace. That's the second thing. Now, third thing, after that, when you did it, you did Elisarov. In Elisarov, it was a distal fracture. So there are two things. One is whether you pan the knee joint and went to tibia for a better stability, number one. And whether you have done the corticotomy proximally. Have you done that?
No, sir. We discussed with the patient that proximal corticotomy and limb lengthening was not done. The patient was ready to accept the shortening. And even we were thinking if we could get the achieve the union, we can go for the lengthening later on. And knee joint was not spanned because the distal fragment was short. But I was able to take the two rings in the distal fragment and have laser fixator. And a static compression after the 2 cycles of compression dissection. No bone grafting was used. But knee range of motion was advised. Knee was not spanned at that time. And after the fixator was out, I was very scary to advise the patient to do the knee range of motion. Because I was telling it might go pretty fracture again. But during knee joint was not spanned. just because I wanted to give the patient a mid-range of motion, but somehow he didn't gain it.
We'll come to that, Dr. Mirin Joshi.
I just wanted to the first message which he said is once the implant, once the case is infected, you say, he said that the implant should be taken out. So I actually feel that in a stable situation, the implant definitely can stay on. And if if it doesn't respond to the antibiotics, which will be obviously according to culture and sensitivity, then only the implant should go out. That is what I personally feel.
How long do you wait, Dr. Milind Doshi, for the antibiotic response?
I may wait for 3 weeks, but
exactly. That's why I said we wait for 1 month. We wait for 1 month, and if it doesn't respond, then implant has to go out.
I'm just curious to know a lateral view of the plate after, because I haven't seen a lateral view of the plate, because if it was in distraction in the beginning, it's a stiff construct which he the primary fixation which was done, and if it was fixed in distraction, then when I know that this is not going to unite, then I would definitely remove it, but not for the sake of the removal or getting rid of infection.
Immediately post operated acute osteomyelitis, acute infection. What should be the mode of delivery of the antibiotic? Because he was debrided, what the patient told us, and he had been debrided at the institute with a wash and all. There was no antibiotic put locally. So should we, the debridement should be just a routine debridement, we'll do, open it, take all the antibiotic and the tissue out, wash it, close it, put a drain. Or we should be putting the local antibiotic, we should be delivering the antibiotic in the concentration of the local also. What should the protocol? In acute osteomyelitis, the implant
is during debridement, the basic protocol is to remove all the infected tissue, first thing. And second, all dead tissue. These are the two things, because as long as the dead tissue...
Can I ask one question?
Sure, Dr. Shinde, yeah.
Dr. Joshi had asked the question, whether the principle of blocking plate is followed or not, and whether there is a lateral X-ray is there or not, to know enough stability was there or not.
Dr. Kale, can you show the slide? Can you show the slide?
I show the slide, but I would like to know, I was not the primary surgeon of the fracture.
Discussing about the infection, but as far as primary fixation is concerned, it was not adequate and the principles were not followed there properly.
I took from the patient, we have known the primary fixation, AP and the lateral view.
Dr. Chandra, you want to comment anything on primary fixation?
It was a long spinal fracture. It looks reasonably okay.
Regarding the question of antibiotic delivery in the infected, now regarding fixation, yes, I think there are multiple points to be discussed there. So it could have been a bit more elastic, that is fine. But once infection was there, what I usually like to do is we remove the implant, we keep those holes curated out, again refix the same plate with new set of screws and putting antibiotic cover onto the plate. So it gives two functions. One, sufficient antibiotic delivery is there. Secondly, the stability also is there. And we also put a mantle of cement in two hemicylinders all around the fracture site, completely removing the dead bone. So if say suppose around 3 inches, 4 inches or 5 inches of bone which is removed, so that is covered with two hemicylinders of bone, and then that is kept so the patient can start with immediate function also. They will start them with immediate partial bed bearing, so that whatever osteopenia has happened, whatever muscle bulk is lost, that also is kept going. So this helps the patient to lessen the infection, efficient elution of antibiotic from a good mantle of cement and a stability. And at around 6 weeks, when everything settles down, then we would like to do a masculine step two. That is what my protocol would do.
So the message is, if you want to retain the implant initially, when the acute osmosis pitch is there, the antibiotic delivery should be locally also.
Locally also, yes.
And sir, how you mix the antibiotic, like normal cement with the gentamicin or some antibiotic cement, 2 gram or 4 gram antibiotics, vancomycin only, or the vancoplus imipenem. In your experience, what kind of antibiotics?
Most of these patients would have a resistance to routine antibiotic, but in a high dose vancomycin they are sensitive. Mm-hmm. Also, they would need colistin. So, colistin is a heat sensitive antibiotic. So, it can remain viable in the cement mantle. So, I mix colistin 9 dicumet 3 vials. And vancomycin around 4 to 5 grams in a cement of around 40 grams. Also, if we have a gentamicin powder or amikacin powder, which I have procured, so I also like to use amikacin if the bacteria is sensitive to amikacin. So, but we need a powder of vancomycin, powder of amikacin, or powder of gentamicin. If it's a liquid, it is not possible.
So, Dr. Shinji, you want to say something?
Considering the length of the fracture, plate is short.
I think the implant is not too bad.
It could have been better.
But then it is not so bad that it will require the implant removal.
That may be one of the reason for the infection, as the fracture is not stably fixed. And secondly, for the culture sensitivity also, you should say to know what antibiotic we should use, and specifically you should tell the microbiologist, we want this antibiotic culture, those who are heat stable. It is not generalized culture sensitivity, as if you have planned for the antibiotic rod or the antibiotic beads.
In this particular X-ray, Dr. Thalia, there is definitely a sequestrum which is seen. Yes. Okay, a comminuted piece. So when you see a sequestrum in the day one, one has to go for thorough debridement. I was just telling same thing. In the primary debridement, in the initial infection, we can go down and remove all the infected tissue and all the loose bone which is not attached to the soft tissue. But when the time is passed around 1 or 2 months, then you have to see whether we can find that in the femur, because it is there is no tunica also, thing which is not dealing. So as long as sequestrum is there, whatever amount of the antibiotic you are using, even for locally also, that will act in, because our defense mechanism do not reach the necrotic areas. So that is as far as debridement is concerned. Yeah.
Point is very well taken, sir, because this was a picture at 4 months. And in our scenario, with 100 to 200 running OPD with almost all the beds full, this patient was not given a proper approach. And just seeing this X-ray, I missed there was osteolysis here. Bone was getting osteolysis.
There is definitely
that should change. And whenever we see a case of infection, it should be given utmost importance. That process is taken. For the wrong on my part, the first debridement which I did with the implant in situ should not be there.
At this scenario, I would like to ask,
how many of you will be thinking that only this segment should be out? Or how many will be, the seniors will be thinking that all this specific fragment should go out?
Only the dead bone has to go out. The bone which is not dead should not go out. Very simple.
I would agree with Dr. Karne here. Whatever seems to be loose dead bone, that you can excise, because what happens is once you tend to shorten, then you do get bleeding bone, and the moment you get bleeding bone, it tells you that this is definitely a vitalized kind of a bone. So shortening probably and removal of necrotic bone is very, very important step of debridement, and of course implant removal as well, if it really doesn't, the surface implant doesn't settle the infection after debridement.
Professor Sharma, you unmute your this. Okay, Dr. Mohan, you can comment till then.
The way to know that when you have reached the viable bone is the paprika sign. what we tell. You go on nibbling out and see whenever there is a punctate fluid appears, that is the healthy bone, and there you stop.
Exactly,
number two, if the patient is affording, we put this stimulant along with antibiotics inside the medullary canal, because the advantage of stimulant that you can put it inside the medullary canal. This bone cement antibiotics you cannot put inside the medullary canal. It has to be around that fracture site or maybe outside. So small pellets of the stimulant admixed with antibiotics can be put, and it releases antibiotic for a longer time compared to the bone cement.
The point very well taken, sir. The only issue was like I told you, it's a poor patient, liver patient, the
stimulant.
Yeah, liver patient. Okay. It was an industrial cortical infection. So in my mind it came that I should be delivering the antibiotic here also, I should be delivering the antibiotic here also.
Stimulant is always better, but the cost factor is there. Cost factor is there. Stimulant is always far superior than any other cement antibiotic, any treatment for the antibiotic. Professor Sharma.
Yeah, my question to Dr. Kalia, very nice presentation, but I would like to ask that you did multiple debridements.
No, sir, I did not do multiple debridements. Multiple debridements have been already done.
Okay.
I did only one debridement and then we went for the definitive plan.
Okay. So, to know what was the extent of debridement, did you take help of some contrast PD or some retinoclide scanning or something like that?
No, sir, nothing that sort of investigation was done. Everything was relied on the clinical judgment. And once this fragment was out, I started nibbling this fragment, and I was not very sure about so-called papillary sign, because somewhere here I was seeing some bleeding, but all this bone, I was not very happy with so-called papillary sign. I wanted to take it out, but I was susceptible, so I thought of giving it a chance. If the patient agrees in a second time, it's not settling, I will go for the corticotomy and the radical debridement of the bone.
Yeah, because if we have a pre-op idea as to what is the extent of debridement to be done, we can already pre-plan our surgeries.
Yes,
that would have been mandatory. Yeah.
Right. Well, now the last, I'll just put a last comment now, because we have to go for other cases. In this particular scenario, on the day one, when we remove the implant and when you do the thorough debridement, I would have gone for urethra fixation and I would have done the corticotomy on day one also. Because corticotomy helps in two ways. One, it helps for the rapid regeneration of the rapid bone formation and the veneer. Second thing, it helps to gain the length which the patient did not get the. And third thing, it is said, it is used to say that the infection burns in the fire of the regenerate. So these are the three important advantages of the doing corticotomy on day one. Okay, thank you. You want to add anything more, Dr. Kalia? Because
so, the next message is, if we have a definitive plan, it can be a single stage surgery. If we are going for a dissection osteogenesis, then you should go for the union first and infection will be taken care of by itself. And if you have to fight infection, you have to fight it hard and aggressively. These are the take home message, I think.
Dr. Shinde, sir?
In this case, considering the infection, it is better to concentrate on union first. Because the only metaphyseal area where we usually do corticotomy and do lengthening, that has already infected. At upper side, there is always risk whether the corticotomy will unite or not. So better to achieve first union in this case. And if needed, personally I will think we can do lengthening in tibia rather than touching that infected bone. I do agree in the presence of corticotomy, in the presence of newborn generally, this infection will burn. It is risky to femur to do these things.
Yeah, that is a very surgery, it is a demanding surgery, and one who is a very worse with the femur elisa, because femur elisa is absolutely different ballgame as compared to tibia one. So one who is a master in doing the femur elisa can go ahead directly with that. Otherwise, what is the second option of the option B can be used? Well, fine, we have to wind up, Dr. Kari, if you just have a...
I think from Dr. Shinde's comment, I just try to reinforce that my apprehensions were founded, but I was right in going cautiously, going for the union first, and then...
That is a better option for the person who is not doing ELISARA so frequently.
Yes.
But in an ideal situation, if you have got a good ELISARA surgeon along with you, who has got a good experience, then I can go primarily. Otherwise, all of us who are the not only doing only LISA, we are the general orthopedic surgeons, we can go for the option B as Dr. Shinde said.
Thank you. What about the compression restriction cycle, sir? One question, last question.
Locally, without osteogenesis, doesn't have that. That is third thing. Compression distraction at the local site, if you are finding the gap is there and there is no adequate bone formation, that does help, but that's according manual, that's what is said. Yes. But generally that is used for the regenerate rather than that is rather using for the bone union. That compression is used for the regenerate. When you get a poor regenerate, that according manual does help, but as compared to that, it doesn't much help at the fracture site. Acute docking, the docking and the the bone ends contact, each maximum bone contact with each other is more important for the bone union, and then according manual at the corticotomy site does help. Okay, thank you very much. We'll go for, because we got almost 45 minutes. We have, it's more than that, we have lost here because there are almost 7 other cases to be discussed. Thank you very much, Dr. Sandeep Kale, and it was a great discussion and great input from all the faculties. Thank you very much. I will go to Dr. Sanjay Thakur from Hamirpur for his case. Dr. Sanjay Thakur.
Good morning to all.
Actually, it is 15 minutes for every case. Now, we have already spent 1 hour and 15 minutes in this case. There are two cases. So, we will go rapidly now.
Am I audible?
Yeah, sure.
Good morning to all. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee of the Momentum 2020 for giving me this opportunity. I'm not wasting much time. I am proceeding with this case. This is a 50-year-old male presented with roadside accident. There is a history of pain, swelling and deformity in the right low limb. Patient was in grade 2 hypovolemic shock, which was managed, and patient was stabilized. There is no visceral injury, chest injury or head injury. Now this is the immediate x-ray of the patient. Patient had fracture neck of femur with ipsilateral segmental fracture shaft of femur. Now how to approach this patient? There are fracture at three levels, at the level of neck of femur, at subtrochanteric level, and at the level of supracondylar femur. So we have various options. We can go through close reduction or open reduction. Either we can use single implant or two implants. Again, we can how to fix the fracture, from proximal to distal fixation or from distal to proximal fixation. Again, in case of implant, we can use a single long sphalomedullary nail or proximal femoral nail. We can use double implants like screws for neck femur, anti-grade intramedullary nailing from the segmental fracture. We can also use DHS and distal femoral nail. Again, another option is screws for the neck femur and distal femoral nail for the segmental fracture. Again, the dynamic hip screw and distal femoral locking plate. So these are the various options available with us. Now, what the literature says regarding these type of fractures. Now, the ipsilateral fracture neck femur and fracture shaft femur was first described in 1953 by Delaney and Stray. Intramedullary nail was used at that time for the fixation of the fracture shaft femur, and knowledge pin was used to fix the fracture neck of the femur. In 1996, Alho et al. Classified these type of fractures as complex femoral fractures. So he used cephalomedullary nails for these patients, and this is a locked intramedullary construct with locking screw in the femoral neck, and distal femoral controls a complex fracture situation well. Now this is the picture showing nail used by Alho et al. In 1996. Now, what about the implant? Powell et al. In 2011 used two implants. He concluded that two implants are sufficient for the osteosynthesis of one of them stabilizing one end of the femur together with the shaft, and while the other implant is used for treating the opposite end of the femur. Now, in 2015, Von Ruden et al. gives three method for treating these type of fractures. One is rendezvous technique. In this technique, he used combination of retrograde intramedullary nailing and dynamic hip screw for the hip fracture. Again, the second option is all-in-one devices like long sphalomedullary nail. And the third option is conventional surgical technique, that is two non-overlapping overlapping implants. So, in this study, he achieved good result in 77.8% cases where he used all-in-one implant and 77.7% in rendezvous technique and in 75% of the conventional technique. But there is no statistically significant difference in the complication rate in his study. Now, this is a systemic review done by Kunal Mohan et al. In 2019 regarding segmental fracture. In this systemic review, he has demonstrated that ipsilateral concomitant fracture of the neck femur and shaft femur, which occur in a young patient following high trauma, high energy trauma, are associated with relatively low rates of complication and successful union and a favorable functional outcome following prompt fixation. Complication rates may potentially differ between single and separate device fixation strategies, but due to the paucity of randomized studies limit the ability to recommend a single or a separate device treatment approach. Now, the studies with adequately powered sample size is required to definitely compare the management strategy in this rare but complex injuries. So till date, as per literature, there is no definite strategy for these type of fractures. Now this is the case, we are coming back to this case. So what B-rate? B-rate, closed reduction and internal fixation with proximal femoral nail. Now what are the tips for doing this procedure? The positioning of the patient is very important. Patient should be positioned in a proper position. C-arm positioning should be at an appropriate level. The reduction of the neck and intertrochanteric fracture of the femur is prerequisite, and not before going for fixation. Reduction at the fracture table should be maintained, and once the reduction is achieved, it is temporarily fixed with K-wires. Now the bias of the neck femur is never acceptable. There should be accurate entry point for the proximal femoral nail. Otherwise, it is very the proximal fracture will go into varus, and that is not acceptable. Now reaming over guide wire should be done, and preferably with power reamer, but at a slow rate. And choose adequate size nail and never hammer the nail. Otherwise, it will displace the proximal fracture. And choose appropriate size of the leg screw with good positioning, and keep the limb in a neutral position before doing the distal locking. Now this is the skin incision. Now this is after X-ray after 6 months follow up. So all the fractures united well, and there is full range of motion at knee and hip, and patient gait is normal. So take home message. The complex multi-level femoral fractures are difficult to manage. So these are the high energy injuries. There are high chances of associated injuries like visceral injuries, head injuries and chest injuries. Again, during management strategy, we have to assess that we have to go for primary definite fixation or we have to go for a damage control orthotics. If patient has a chest injury, has a head injury, we can go for a damage control orthotics. We can do the primary stable fixation of the hip fracture and do external fixation of the shaft fracture, and later on when patient is stabilized, we can go for definite fixation. Thorough clinical and radiological evaluation should be done, and the choice of implant depends upon the type and site of fracture and surgeon's experience. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay Kumar. Any comments from the faculty?
Sir, can I ask? Hello?
Yeah.
Sir, looking at the fracture, actually in this case, the neck femur fracture is pretty undisplaced. So the plan of the treatment, whether to go for a single implant or double implant, will majority will depend on the neck femur displacement. So I will ask to Sanjay sir, what will be your plan?
Yeah.
If your neck femur fracture is displaced, so what will be your plan B?
Plan B will be if we are not able to reduce the fracture neck femur in a closed technique, we have to go for an open reduction of the neck femur fracture, and then we have to fix it with a separate implant. Then two different implants should be used to fix this fracture.
Okay, okay.
Shall I give
one
practical tip? See, the reduction of the proximal the neck femur fracture is very, very, very important. So, you can put the two sternum pin or one sternum, thick sternum pin in the upper third of the femur, and we can use that as a joystick to reach the neck femur, stabilize that with the help of that, and direct to KYS or the bed wires, and then go for the main fixation. You can achieve reduction in displaced fracture as if so that with this joystick.
Sir, another, if you want to go for open reduction, because you have taken the patient on a fracture table. So, doing a Smith-Peterson approach on the fracture table is very tough. So, what is the best recommended now is, if you are planning for open reduction, or you might think your open reduction is needed, it is better to operate on a simple fracture table. With break other half of the table and bring the opposite limb in the lithotomy position so that you can do the open reduction of the neck femur also, and at the same time you can have a better entry and control over the distal fragment also. This is one of the tips.
Okay. There are advantage and disadvantage of the fracture table and the supine and the lateral position, both things are there, and it depends upon the thickness of the patient. If the patient is a hefty patient, then it is very difficult without the fracture table or on the simple table. Anybody wants to comment anything? Dr. Chandal, Dr. Joshi?
I think that was a wonderful result with a single implant strategy. Yeah, it was well done.
Dr. Joshi, you want to comment? No.
I actually differ from Dr. Pradeep Patil, because I am sure that I can do an open reduction of displaced fracture neck femur on fracture table with Watson Jones approach, because what I do is sometimes I get hold of the clamp, that reduction clamp, and then I manipulate it in relation to the proximal fragment. That is one way. The second way is once you do the anterior arthrotomy with the Watson Jones approach, you can, with the help of a spike or a K wire, you can manipulate the proximal, that is the head and neck part. So it is definitely possible, because somehow I am used to do it on a fracture table. I don't say that doing it in a lateral position might be easy, but I am sure that I can do it on a fracture table. Displaced neck femur also.
My opinion is, whenever there is a displaced fracture, it is better to use two implants.
It's true, sir. It's true.
So the fixation of fracture neck femur just cannot be neglected. It has to be a perfect fixation. Otherwise, we have to repair it later on. The union of shaft femur is not a big job.
Karne sir, you unmute yourself, sir. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. So these are the two points which is taken. One is about the fracture table. Fracture table, the reduction of the proximal fracture is easier. Even for the shaft femur also it is easier, but then the rest of the surgery is easier with fracture table. Second, about the two implants, that two implants are basically better, but then the problem with the stress riser which occurs between the area of the two implants, they are because especially the osteoporotic bone, the chance of fracture in between area.
Any faced men, Any more comment on any more query from others? Fine. Now we'll go for the next case. Yeah, I invite Dr. Sandeep Kashyap for his case now. Dr. Sandeep Kashyap, is he there? Dr. Sandeep Kashyap from Shimla.
Sir, till that time we can start next case.
Yeah, Dr. Chandak, you can go for with your case now.
Yeah.
Sandeep.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You do mute all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah.
Yeah. I am presenting a case of a heel fracture femur and is mostly a retrospective analysis. So this was a patient. This was 3 years post-injury. His fracture femur had healed well. His fracture tibia also had healed well. And he's 32 years old male. Had flexion of only 0 to 40 degrees. Post-op already 3 years have gone. There was no pain. He was working in a vehicle factory and wanted an implant removal for further flexion. That was what his desire was. The first surgeon removed the implant as it looked very well and he was absolutely fully functional. So these are the x-rays after implant removal and he had an insurance benefit for which for submitting to the insurance company. The x-rays were also taken post-operatively after implant removal. After the implant removal, uneventful wound healing, patient consulted the factory doctor also, went to join, and after seeing him walking very well, perfectly all right, patient joined back duty in a vehicle factory at around 6 weeks post-op. And he worked there without any problems. But during one of the working days, he got pain in thigh. These are the x-rays after implant removal. You can look at the x-rays of both tibia as well as the femur. They were done in the same sitting. And suddenly, during working, he developed pain in thigh. And after 2 or 3 days, he was then again not able to walk at all. So at this point of time, the opinion whether the implant should not have been removed, was it a non-union? Did he needed more rest before he went to work and before certifying him to be able to work? And what next? All investigations were normal, including calcium, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase, serum creatinine, CRP, SR. Clinically, there were no signs of infection. So looking back at these x-rays, so these are the four questions pertinent in mind. And these were the questions which even the patient was asking.
Yeah.
So looking back, so, can I invite opinion at this point of time?
Sure. Yes. I will comment one thing. Whenever I remove any plate implant, latex implant, I ask the patient to take care for the next 6 weeks. Rather, I make the patient non-bed bearing if there are six or more screws in the bed bearing bone. So, these are lessons to be learned from this because apparently this bone was united because there is no sclerosis in the fracture. The only one thing which I see in the fracture in the femur. There is a sequestrum and there is a cavity which became obvious after removal of the implant because this x-ray is having little poor contrast. So still here we can find one bone which is sequestrum which is there in the lower third, and in the next x-ray you will find that there is a cavity around that. So probably there may be the small infection which is at that here you can find, and that's why the bone was weak. That is one part, and second was the bone has fractured through the screw holes, you know, there. Yes. And that's why, and then there was sclerosis at the bone end, so that indicates it was not non-union.
Yes.
First of all, it was infection, second, early very very. Especially in the hip patient.
So, I would also agree with Karne sir.
Yeah.
And one thing is, union is one thing, but you know, little careful when we allow, you know, let these people bear weight.
So, given choice, you would not have removed his implant. That is what
it is. 3 years post-op. 3 years post-op. So, implant can be removed. And 3 years post-op.
Okay. Now,
three years have passed. So, one can remove the implant. But at the same time, you should warn him to have orthosis for a long period, because all plate synthesis, there is risk of stress fracture after one's removal of the implant.
I would just like to add one point.
Yeah.
I think that we should insist on getting an oblique views also before removal of implant. And honestly, I don't hesitate to quote Dr. Sharad Rao, who is a very respected person at Manipal. I remember him having told that locking plates should not be removed unless the patient wants. In this particular case, probably he wanted a better range of motion. So, I personally feel that whether we should dynamize these plates, remove few screws and then like that, because essentially it's an external fixator, and suddenly if we remove it, this can happen. I'm specifically quoting his name.
So, specifically what you mean to suggest, you would have removed few screws? Close the wound, allowed him to work, and then remove the whole plate?
Yes. I have done this in two cases. Right now I can't share them, but I will send it across on our group. And in those cases, I have removed few screws, waited for 3 months, again remove one or two screws. I have explained that this can be risky and dangerous, because all these fractures were like this. Now, looking at this fracture, this must have been a segmental long spanning fracture. So,
yes.
So ideally, either a CT scan before removal.
It's a
very dangerous fracture.
So, this was the fracture. So, now analyzing.
I want to ask the faculty, how many of you do practice this thing? This is stage-wise implant removal. No, how many have done this up till now?
Frankly speaking, I have either removed the implant and warned them that take precautions, take some support, of course with weight bearing, but take some support and be careful. However,
I want to point out, sir, that one should not remove implant to get the knee flexion. See, yes. He failed that he will get more knee flexion after removing implant. 3 years down the line, implant has got no role in causing the knee stiffness, and
yes.
I will say otherwise, that in removal of the implant, if you are doing the quadriceps patch at the same time, say for example you are removing all the quadriceps from the femur up and then rather to get the knee flexion, but implant removal alone will not give knee flexion. Rather, if the patient tries to flex the knee more and more after removal of implant, then the chance of the fracture are more like this. Second thing, if at all patient has got knee stiffness and removal of implant, what I do, I first do the manipulation before starting surgery. That is one thing, because the implant is there, and when you are doing the manipulation, the stress which comes on the bone is a implant. Do the manipulation and then remove the implant to get the more knee flexion. But removal of the implant only for the knee flexion should be discouraged.
Yes, I totally agree.
Yeah. Sir, one thing, I am very skeptical regarding removal of the distal femoral plates, because as if you see, there is a pre-op exchange, very complex fracture, and usually it is better to have confirmation of union by CT scan, because I have a couple of cases where the x-ray looks very good, but when you do a CT scan, there is definitely signs of a non-union. So before removing a distal femur plate, it's very important to confirm the union, because when you remove it and start mobilizing the knee, as the professor says, there is a lot of stress going to be on the fracture when the patient is going to bend the knee.
But in this particular case, I don't think there was non-union. There are no signs of non-union.
No, yes,
yeah. So points very well taken, that removal of distal femur plate should not be taken lightly in the patient.
Yeah.
So, analyzing what happened, so this was the X-ray after injury, this is for analysis. So, this was a segment which was comminuted, this is the lateral view, it was a closed injury, and this was the post-op 6 months, this was the cerclage wire used, and this is the zone where patient had a poor healing potential, this was the healing, except for the restriction of movement, the patient had completely recovered. And this is what the fracture site is. So the fracture site is just above the zone of cerclage wire.
It is still higher, sir. It is still higher.
Just above that. So this is the fracture. So this was... Yeah, go ahead, please.
I would like to ask Tanya, sir.
Yeah.
Will the part is the plastic with the plate on or without the plate?
With the plate. With the plate. When you expose the plate.
What is the plastic with the plate? Or what is the plastic with the plate out?
Will it with be, the plate in, some it is easier to
remove. Rehabilitation of the patient. There will be some issues with apprehension of getting a refracture after doing the corticoplasty also. Because during the range of motion, after the gain of that motion, with the plate out, is there any apprehension of getting the fracture?
Well, by corticep fracture, I don't mean lengthening of the corticep tendon or the corticep muscle. Okay. No, what I mean is just taking off all the fibrosis from the anterior part of the femur. Because now there is a good vascularity at that area after 3 years. So you can take off all along with the periosteum, you lift up everything and you will immediately find, and at the same time you start manipulating. Sometimes you have to expose the knee joint also there and take out all the adhesions which are in the knee joint. But there is no need to lengthen the quadriceps or the damage the quadriceps per se. So the post-op rehabilitation is not affected. Post-op rehabilitation affects when you are lengthening the quadriceps by thread plastic. So that I am not doing that quadricep plastic.
No, sir, I am saying just release of the adhesions, but to retain that motion after the surgery, if the plate is in situ, we will have confidence. But if the plate is out, then to retain that motion, with some manipulation or something.
Great. On table, the manipulation is done with the plate in situ. When you remove the plate, on table you know how much flexion you have got. In the post-operative period, we do two things. We start immediate post-operative CPM. So he can get at least 90 degree of the movement, that is number one. And because in the post-op period, if you start the CPM earlier, initially there are fibrinous adhesions post-operatively. These fibrinous adhesions get converted into fibrous adhesions later on. So we should avoid formation of fibrinous adhesion itself in the post-op period. So in the post-op period, you start CPM every day. The patient can tolerate it better if it starts immediately post-operatively, even when the anesthesia is there. That is one part. So, one can do immediate post-operative, but second most important part is the avoidance of bed bearing. For all femur and TBI patients, when I remove the plate and screws, I ask them non-bed bearing for 6 weeks. That is the key.
Okay.
Hello?
Yeah.
Karne sir, can I say something?
Yes, please.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, we are listening. Go ahead.
These type of cases are very common after removal of a nail or plate. Before removal, you can see there is a very good union, but after removal, there is little bit of stress and that gives away. So better to protect all this type of fracture post-operatively, a brace support for a 4 to 6 weeks minimum.
Okay. Now, this is the patient. This is the fracture. Now, how do I heal this patient? A nail construct, a plate construct, or a nail with a bone graft, or a nail and plate construct. And how easy it would be to nail this fracture with a blocked medullary cavity here and fragments uniting. There is no medullary cavity here, no medullary cavity. So any thought now what to proceed?
I think, sir, you will have to a composite implant.
Okay.
Probably a single implant may not do the job. And definitely here you will have to use an intramedullary implant, do a thorough debridement of the medullary canal, try and reform the medullary canal proximally and distally. But you may also have to use a supporting implant in an external fixator, or if there is no infection, then probably a plate. So a single implant here is not going to help. You will have to use a combination.
So there was no infection. Clinically it was not there. The tissue cultures were negative. And there was no pus during the exploration also. So this patient, as you suggested,
my opinion is here intramedullary implant is preferred because it does give good stability here. But there is a lot of difficulty intraoperatively for the intramedullary implant. You know, to find the medullary canal and to remit and to in a sclerotic bone like this, especially in the proximal fragment, if you find there is sclerosis, it becomes very difficult. If you can get the intramedullary canal, and if you are
I like to one question. What is the range of movement as a knee joint?
So when he presented with a fracture, So getting the range of one, but before the implant removal, it was 0 to 40 degrees.
So 0 to 40 means he was having very less movement.
Yes, he was stiff. He was stiff.
So even we can try laser also.
Yes, possibly.
So about intermittent implant, I was saying that it is a better in this particular case. There is one more thing in the distal third vertebrae, the cavity which we see, it is surrounded by all sclerotic bone. Sometimes, yes, you know, like a sort of broad abscess, and which may be asymptomatic in some of the patients. So if you, when you open it and now in the fracture case, you start removing there, and if you find the pus which is there, then we have to go for external fixator or the laser, what Dr. Shindya said. But if there is no infection in that particular area, of course we can go for bone scan. Bone scan can give us idea whether there is infection at that site. But then after, if there is no infection, I will still prefer intramedullary implant. And in intramedullary implant, distally, it is better to have three screws and protect the, even if it is intramedullary implant, it is better to protect the patient for at least 6 to 8 weeks. If you protect them, intramedullary implant alone will be sufficient to stabilize this fracture.
And in this patient, there was no infection. So this was the skin condition, it was all healthy, and on exploration also there was no infection. We thought of doing a intramedullary nailing, and it was difficult. So we had to use an incremental reaming. So we used reamers from starting from 8, 8.5, 9. Incremental reaming was done, holding it with clamp, because there was a lot of reamer chatter when the reaming was being done, because it was all sclerotic and there was endosteal bone also. So gradual reaming over a period of almost 45 minutes we took to ream, cool it down with under irrigation. And after reaming, we were able to manage an intramedullary interlocking nail fixation. And in addition, we had augmented derotation plate or augmentation plating along with bone grafting along the envelope of bone. And this patient did very well postoperatively. He healed well. So this is where we started with. And we were able to nail it and did well. Now, during the surgery, we provided him with a arthroscopic knee release. He had parapatellar gutter, a lot of fibrosis, and he is at present around 80 degrees of knee flexion and is comfortably joined back on his duties and he is doing well. But a point learned well that after a plate removal in distal femur, we have to give them sufficient time to heal. So we don't take implant removal lightly, and one point I learned was obtain a check x-ray after all implant removal because it may prove you handy. Thank you for patient listening. Any questions, I'll be ready to answer.
Okay, again, from medical care purpose, it's always better to have post-op x-ray after removal of implant as well as after reduction of the dislocation, especially shoulder dislocation.
Yes.
Right, sir. Professor Sharma, you can unmute yourself. Sharma wants to ask something.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, sir.
So, for this, if you could get the knee range of motion up to 90 with the release and all, for this, would we have gone for the distal femoral nail, sir? Retrograde nailing?
Yes, that was possible, but since the knee flexion was restricted, doing a distal femur nail was a bit difficult. It was only 0 to 40 degree, so not possible.
During the release, the fragment we are seeing in the canal, was it an infection or was it a loose segment of the previous fracture?
No, it was just a butterfly which was healing in that position. There was no infection at all, absolutely. His ESR was 5, his CRP was less than 5, and there was no clinical infection and there was no evidence intraoperatively also. So absolutely no infection. Only thing, the healing, whatever has happened, was sclerotic.
So the plate which is applied, are you having some plan to take the plate out to have the benefit of the nail later on?
So right now this patient is now post-operatively more than 2.5 years and is absolutely fine. Neither he nor me is interested in removal. So he is not interested.
Dr. Shali, this retrograde intermittent nail will not be suitable in this particular area because it is a little bit in the middle third, and the proximal locking is difficult in a thick patients. Proximal screw locking in the retrograde intermittent nail. But this particular antegrade is always superior as compared to IMSC or intermediary supracondylar nails. Dr. Professor Sharma, you want to say something?
Yeah, sir. You have used intermediary nail. May I ask why to apply plate along?
Yeah, when we fixed with nail, and the rotated, there was some amount of instability which we noted. Also, I like to put sclerotic and not healing. So I wanted to put a plate of bone taken out from the inner crest of ileum. So this is a table of bone which I often commonly do, that put a plate of bone inside this plate and fix it up so that there is no rotational instability. Since this area is a trumpeting end of the bone, so to augment the fixation, the plate was applied. And as there was no infection at all, I was not afraid of putting an additional implant.
Very good.
Yes,
Absolutely, you manage. Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Very, thank you. Thank you. Means there is no another chance of giving of the implants if you put a additional plating along with this nail.
Good. Yeah.
I like to suggest one.
Sir, go ahead.
There is a one implant sign nail which can be used retrogradely, and it has got this very good quality of zinc, where distal as well as proximal are locked up without any radiological control.
Okay. Good point.
Chanda sir, very well done.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you.
Get in touch with him, Dr. Umpal.
Let me first thank MOA as well as BOS for giving me the opportunity to share my case with you. And so this was a 34-year male who met with a motor vehicular accident. He also had a head injury, and it was a simple closed shaft, mid-shaft fracture. And unfortunately, patient developed a fat embolism. He was on ventilator for 6 weeks. They developed respiratory infection, empyema, and all that stuff. And actually, the case was handed over to me by the intensivist at the end of 3 months. So actually, I have not seen the patient on day one. I have seen the patient directly at the end of 3 months. That was the original X-ray. This was done in 2008. And this is the time when I came into the picture. So you can see that there is huge callus over there, and approximately 10 centimeters of overriding was there. So I just reviewed the literature. The literature is really very sparse for this, and I'll just because most of the literature is, for example, it is in 2014. Then in 2013 and 15, they have described that you sometimes need to preoperatively apply traction, and sometimes you need to accept femoral shortening also. So the maximum correction which you can do on table, the safe limit they have mentioned as 4 centimeters, and they have described that sometimes you need to do it in 2 stages also. That is, do the osteoclasis and release and apply skeletal traction like that. So the only literature which I could see, which was published in 1995, actually it shows this is that paper which tells that you need to shorten the femur if you are not getting if you are not able to achieve the reduction, and local callus can be used for this thing. No separate need of bone grafting. So my plan was to use Elizarov, and I opened the fracture. I removed maximum amount of callus which I could, and on table I could achieve say 50% only distraction I could achieve. And so So this is the X-ray on day 10, and you can see that I was actually there was the overriding was still persisting, and in the gist of getting distraction, I had created a comminution here, which was not there, and the alignment in the lateral view was not satisfactory. So I kept on over distracting it. Now you can see that I have distracted it adequately, and because my ring placement had to be away from the fracture site, because there was gross overlapping, my ring placement was away from the fracture site. So I later on translated the distal fragment anteriorly, and these are the carbon fiber rings which are not casting their shadows, so I could visualize what is happening over there. And I could not achieve 100% reduction. The obvious reason is my placement of the rings was way away from the motor, the area where I would have loved my actual rings to be there. It was a practical issue. So there was some recurve atom and a little definite valgus, and the patient finally went on to unite in this particular position. So the fixator was there for practically 8 months. I feel that I could have removed it, and this is how he finally remodeled. And so that is his function. You can see the stretching of the soft tissues and the pin tracks which have given me the problems, but finally the range of motion was also good. So you can see his function also. So that was his function. So the take home message is, even in the today, even today, Elizarov definitely remains as a useful and rescue tool in complex trauma situations. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Milind Joshi, for the wonderful case. It is so much overriding and was quite difficult. And one point is taken, especially in the ICU, or the patient is having head injury. There is abundant callus formation which is there in the either femur or tibia. We have seen in such cases, and generally that is not given much importance in the first few weeks if the patient is serious and in the ICU is having more visceral problem than bone. So it was a great case. Anybody wants to ask something or comment something?
Nah, sir, opening such a fracture is very tough, because removing the callus in a 3-month-old head injury patient, the callus is absolutely very hard. So how did you go? Are there any problems? Because there are a lot of going to be some bleeding or something, exposure might be difficult. Yeah.
So because I was really worried, you can see that the fragment, I was really genuinely worried about damaging the neurovasculars also. But I stayed close to the bone. That's the only thing. And I kept on removing the callus. The biggest mistake which I did was I took this case at 6 p.m.
Oh.
That is something which, and I was thinking that I am just going to remove the callus, apply the frame, because in an ideal situation, my ring would have been here in the distal proximal fragment and here in the distal fragment. But because of this much overriding, I had to accept the rings here and here. So next day morning, the HB had dropped from 12 to 6 grams. That is how much he bled. And I was maybe really immature to post him at 6 p.m.
Yeah.
And but then I stopped when I realized that it is mobile and now I can distract it. So
can it be useful if you have used the distractor intraoperatively? Yes. Because holding with the bone holding and distract it is really tough. So can it, would we have, yes, the retrospective, it might have helped you. What do you think, Sushi sir?
I would have used LRS and gradually distracted it out. That's but I wanted a 360 degree control.
AO distractor, I'm asking AO distractor intraoperatively.
But still, that would have given me, I was sure that I won't be able to achieve reduction. So I had mentally prepared that I'm going to achieve a gradual reduction. And in one go, I wanted to do as much as I can without harming the patient.
And the another question, because correcting a translation with multidimensional deformity in a femur, in an Elisera is very tough. Because you want to go into translate one thing, the second deformity appears. So what technique or what, how you use? So anything you use like a hexapod or something like that, or you corrected by just judging?
No. You can use set rods, and you in AP the alignment in fact was good. I wanted to correct the alignment only in the sagittal plane. So there are translation devices which are actually ready-made, available also, and you can prepare them out of your construct also.
Awesome.
Prepare them as per your need, and then you can translate them.
Well, one comment here is that LRS will not be useful in this such an angulated bone. If you come, LRS doesn't have that facility to correct in third dimension of plane. Number two, Elisera is the best in this particular case. The other recent angulated corrector, deformity corrector apparatus which are there, they are there when you are doing osteotomy at one place and you have to just correct the angulation. Now here what is more important than correction of the angulation was the distraction. So that distraction is generally not the easiest way with either the esculap or the AO distractor. That is the ideal way to do it. Means we can try it initially. Without opening it, put the external fixator, start distracting, and see how much you are getting. Now, at one point of time, you don't get more distraction by outside means. Then you can go inside and start laying the fibrosis or the bone which is there. The key here, especially when there is an abundant callus, which is not there in this particular case, but sometimes within 1 month, you see such a great callus as the Dr. Patil pointed out, that is very difficult to distract by external means alone. So there you can go in. The key is that you start from the normal bone. Once you start from the normal bone, start removing from the normal bone, then you won't have any problem, especially. And the second thing, stay close to the bone, as Dr. Milind Joshi said. Whenever you are near any neurovascular structures, if you want to err on the bony side rather than the bony side. But if you start from the normal bone to the fracture side, the removal of the callus is a little bit easier, and your osteotome or the saw, it's better to use osteotome, but it will not deviate from that particular plane. That is just a tip. Anybody wants to add anything more? Elisera has got an excellent way. You see, Elisera is a big science by itself. It's a separate specialty like the arthroplasty or the arthroscopy. You have to learn it. It took me 6 months to learn Elisera in 1990-91 at that time. Then if you understand all the basic principles and you should be mastering the geometry. Generally, the doctors are not good in mathematics. They are good in the biology. But here you require the knowledge of the geometry far more in Elisera to get the best out of the apparatus.
I have one question. As significant number of patients of head injury presents like this, do we have any such protocol that we should apply external fixator at the time of presentation?
You should be consulted by the intensivist for that matter, and of course they do consult when they find a fracture, but instead of just putting the thumb splint or the splint, simple above knee splint, it is better to put external distractor and external fixator in our distractor mode. That is a good idea.
So I am working, yes sir, I am working with neurosurgeons for the last 15 years. So what is our protocol? If the patient is having polytrauma with head injury and if GCAC is above 7, and if they are planning for any neurosurgical intervention, they always recommend us to fix the fracture at the same time. Because it has been shown that if you fix it, the ultimate recovery is very, very fast.
Nursing is easy.
Yeah.
Of course, if the patient is a comatose and they are not planning any surgery at the neuro also, you can put the external fixator in the ICU itself.
Yes.
Taking all due precautions.
First, must have a few other cases. I have another, but then because others should get chance, I will not.
Dr. Joshi will take your second case at the end. Now we'll go for the, I mean, if the time permits, now we'll go for with the next speaker, Dr. Pradeep Patil.
Yes, from
Kolhapur. Yeah, you go ahead with your next case. Hopefully we'll get time for Dr. Joshi's second case also.
So this is a long history. Is a case of a patient had a road traffic accident in 2015. So she was a 50-year male, was obese patient and very heighted person, and he had upper third, lower third fractures. Upper third fracture femur, close fracture and transverse fracture. I don't have his X-ray for injury and post surgery. But according to discussion with the previous surgeon, it was a pretty simple fracture. So, and this was the picture after 1 year after the first surgery, that means in 2016. So, looking at the X-ray, there was a frank non-union and there is a frank non-union. So, what surgeon decided, as the implant is good, then he decided to remove the distal screw after 1 year. So, this is how he removed the distal screw and ask patient to wet bear. Then patient continued on wet bearing, but he doesn't, symptoms doesn't improve, and he started getting feeling of instability around the thigh. Then he again consulted the surgeon, and the surgeon has advised him of exchange nailing and bone grafting. So he has done exchange nailing and bone grafting. So this is the X-ray, and the surgeon was thinking that dynamization is very useful. So after some, I think after 3 months, he again removed the distal two screws, okay, and asked the patient to wet bear. And then patient go on wet bearing. So he started getting knee symptoms. So he started getting repeated knee effusions as well as the knee pain. So for that, they investigated in the form of MRI. So MRI wasn't showing any joint pathology, but a lot of marrow edema. At the same time, they have done a CT scan where it was seen that the fracture is still not united. So the primary surgeon told, it's not now, it's a very tough case, I'm not going to manage it. Advised him to take a second opinion. So he started moving here and there, and in that he spent around 3 years. So this was the picture he presented. So during that 3 years, he continuously continued on bed bearing, due to which there was a lot of loosening of the medullary canal, widening of the canal, and also the telescoping of the telescoping over the fracture site. So that resulted into the distal migration of the neck, and this is now presented to me last in, that means in April 2019. At the same time, he was having a short limb, shortening around 3 centimeters. There was a frank abnormal rotatory instability, and patient was wet bearing, and there was no clinical as well as a other signs of infection. So we decided to offer him a surgery. The problem where first was the whether there was a deep seated infection inside. Second was the, as the is a very old non-union and the bone quality may not be good. And second thing, the third thing was the, we are going to expect a lot of shortening. And the last one was the wide proximal canal. So anything in the proximal canal should be very good fitting. So this was his picture when I passed a reamer from the proximal to distal fragment. So there was a lot of translation. So this translation was due to continuous mobility of the fragment. To reduce that, I have passed one polar wire and centralized the nail, and that was confirmed by passing a reamer and whether the my nail is getting centralized. Then after I had done an exchange nailing long nail, and at the same time I supplemented with plate as well as abundant bone graft. So practically his two iliac crests were removed, and this was his immediate post-operative X-ray. So bone-to-bone contact was good, and this was his X-ray after 3 months. So the problem of with this patient and probably with the